Good evening.
Evening.
Welcome to the second night of our revival. It's so good to see all of you. A lot of you who we saw yesterday and a few folks who we haven't seen until today. It's good to have everybody here tonight. We're going to hear another message from Nathan here in a little while. The Swore family is here for our music this evening. And if you've not heard them before, I was here when they were sound checking. They sound great, so you guys are going to enjoy it. A couple of quick housekeeping notes for our guests. Restrooms are straight back the hall. If you go out either door, just kind of follow it around. And the men's room is basically straight back, and the ladies' room is over on this far side. Also, just a note I just want to make everybody aware of. When I bail out of the service around 8 o'clock, it's not because anything's wrong. It's not because I don't like what Nathan's preaching. I am 100% still a seminary student, and I have class at 8 o'clock. So I'm going to duck back to my office at about 8 o'clock and jump on an online class. I apologize ahead of time, but I've got to be in there. So about 8 o'clock, I will disappear. Heather and Nathan can close the end of the service. Nathan, if you'd close with a word of prayer, and I'll have Heather do the last song. Speaking of singing, if you will grab your favorite hymns of praise, stand and turn to page 370. Excuse me, that's the United Methodist hymnal. I'm sorry, the United Methodist hymnal. Number 370. It's this one. Victory in Jesus. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again, and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption soaring. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Amen. Let's pause for a moment of prayer to open up our evening. Lord, we are so thankful for another night in your house. So thankful for another night of revival. And Lord, we pray that that would be what these services truly are. That these are not just some dates we throw on the calendar and pop up at church a few extra times. But Lord, that we would come to these services and be charged up by your Spirit. Yes. That we would go from this place with that fire burning in us to carry it to the world around us and show them that light of Christ that they so desperately need to see. Lord, revive us again. And fill this place with your Spirit tonight. Touch Nathan as he preaches in just a little while. Touch the Swore family as they bring our music. Lord, let everything said and done be done for your glory. We ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. Well, now I'll ask you to pick up your favorite hymns of praise. I've got the right hymnal this time. Turn over to number 138. 138 in favorite hymns of praise. That's Nothing But the Blood.
The blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon this I seek, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. sin atone. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Naught of good that I have done. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen. You can be seated. And I'm going to ask, let's see, let me get Jim and Ray, let me have you guys do the offering again, if you would. And a brief note about the offering for our folks who weren't here last night. The love offering we take up each night is going to go to our special singers each night. And so please give generously. We want to help support the Swore family and what they do. And so everything that goes in the offering will go to them this evening. Thank you.
Let me just come around this way since I'm already moving this way.
Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. Thanks for moving back in your house. Lord, bless each and every one of us here tonight. Bless the offering that we might be ready to receive. Be with Nathan as he brings the message and the singers as they bring our message and song. We ask this in Jesus' gracious and holy name. Amen.
For that grace he gives us to trust him. Amen?
Amen.
Every day. I am not going to dawdle any longer, so I'm going to have the Swore family come up. Now, a lot of you probably know them. I met them for the first time when we did revival here about 3 years ago, I think it was, when you guys were here. And they sounded great then, but I said this to them earlier. I was like, but now the kids are not so much kids anymore, and their voices have gotten even better. And so these guys are awesome. I'm so excited to have them. So please welcome the Swore family.
takes time for changing, so we should change to trade our old time religion for something new. Our faith is outdated while living in the past. Well, my answer is simple, so if you ask,
I still love to hear how God's love paid the cost. As passion was sacrificed and my nails to a cross, I still love the sound as the saints start to sing. Songs of the blood Jesus shed just for me. I still love an altar where broken ones pray and find what is found in no other way. It may be old-fashioned, but it's
afloat, and I never said. meeting. How many of you can say this? Yes, thank you. I want to take a second and introduce our family real quick. Many of you know us. It's good to see some familiar faces out here. We see these folks right here, what, twice a week at least for the last 5 or 6 years, I think. And I get to see these folks right here twice a week for the last 2 years, and appreciate both of these families. But we are this four family all the way from New Hope Road, or Tater Creek, if you're known as that. But we're so thankful to be here. This is my daughter, Maddie. She sings soprano for us. She's 15. And this is Caitlin, and she is 17. And a senior. Unbelievable, isn't it? Unbelievable. But we're so thankful to be here. And I always like to mention, we're not here to do a concert. We gave up on that a long time ago. We're here to have church. And if that means we need to sit down there in that pew, we'll do it. Have it. We're here to worship the Lord. And I'm thankful that we serve a God who is faithful. Amen. In good times and bad times, He is faithful. And this is probably my favorite song that we sing right now. And it simply says, there's never a time that He's not faithful.
Storm just won't break.
to do one more for you, Pastor Robert, if you could come on ahead. Jeff, I'm always trying to run myself out of a job. I don't have to try too hard, do I? A couple months ago, we had the opportunity to sing down at Mount Calvary with the Down East Boys, which was a really big deal for us, and we were so excited about it. And I got COVID and couldn't go. And our assistant pastor had to fill in, and I thought I was kicked out of the Swore family. I thought there was going to be somebody else. Well, then, about a month ago, we had a revival in our church. C.T. Townsend was there, and if y'all ever heard him sing, he's amazing. And the girls got to sing with him. And Jeff, being the nice guy that is, had to send me a text and tell me how it's out. But they're going to sing one with Robert now, and I love this song. It's an old hymn. If you guys know it, please sing it. I love the message. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. Y'all listen.
So you might need a job. If I can get the cord up out of the way here, I'll be in business. There we go. Give that. That'll work. As long as that'll sit there, that'll be okay. And Ron, I'll scoot your table back here in just a second. Okay. Got a hymnal up here for lyrics. So let me play it in the key it's written in. That would be a problem.
Love.
I'll still let David keep his job, but I wouldn't mind if they sing one once in a while. And what a beautiful job you guys did. Thank you so much. I gotta tell you, I know I'm not in front of the camera, I'm only gonna be here. It's something really special to watch people use their talents that God has given them to give the glory back to Him. And to see a family doing that together.
That's right.
That's an awesome thing.
Yes, it is.
And so I'm so glad that you guys could come. Thank you. Nathan, I don't think you need a long introduction, so come on, brother. Bring the message. Huh?
Oh, I do remember one thing about this church, and that these pews are not built for people over 6 foot tall.
They're not built for four people either.
Yes. Whew. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
I tell you what, I said it yesterday, and I'll say it again. Today is one of those days where I don't really have to preach, because the Spirit's already been here. The Spirit's already been ministering to us, and we are just blessed. See, now Robert's got stuff laying up here. He's got all my stuff messed up. I'm still just joking. This morning, you can tell I'm used to doing this. This evening, rather, we're going to begin in the book of John. John chapter 14, the first 14 verses. And it says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe on account of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I am going to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? Father, I'll say it again. We stand here already a richly blessed people. And for that, I give you thanks. For the privilege that we have to be able to come and gather together in safety and to worship your name and raise our voices and just sing as loud as we want. For that, O Lord, I give you thanks. And we pray for our brothers and our sisters around this world who do not share in that same blessing, and pray your protection and safety on them. Father, now as we come to this time of message, I simply pray once again, Father, that you would open wide the floodgates of your Holy Spirit, that in your power, in your glory, you would pour down upon all of us gathered here today. Whether we are here or whether we are watching from home, Lord, that it would be your Spirit that ministers to us, and that, Lord, that as your power washes through us, Lord, that if we stand on any foundation that is not the true foundation in Jesus Christ, that we would be shook, that we might move to stand on that sure foundation. I pray that as your Spirit moves, Lord, that you would give us a very simple blessing, that you would make us uncomfortable, that you would fill us so much with Your Spirit and to overflow, Lord, that You would give us dreams and visions and guide us, O Lord, that we just can't help but be uncomfortable lest we follow after You. So, Father, in all things this night, I pray that You would take me and hide me behind Your cross, that this is Your word for Your glory alone, for the transformation of all of us, myself including. And I pray, O Lord, that the meditations of my heart and the words of my mouth would be found acceptable unto You. And all God's children said, Amen. The way, the truth, and the life. I love this. One of the ways that I know the Bible is real, and that there were just some people that didn't just sit down and try to write some things for us to establish a religion on, is because you don't take the founders of your faith and make them look like the Three Stooges quite as often as they do. Because consistently, Jesus will ask the disciples a question, or the disciples will ask Jesus a question, and it just falls so short, and it reveals their humanity in such a big way. You know, Thomas asked this question, you know, what do you mean we know where you're going? We don't know where you're going half the time. You wake us up half the time and say we're going this way, get your stuff. What do you mean we know where you're going? And he goes, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Which means that the way is the roadmap for our life. And that roadmap begins and ends in Jesus Christ. I can't tell you how many people I know come to churches, come to my church, come to the pastor and talk, and they're searching for meaning. Because they've been told in this world that you can find meaning in all these different places, but what they keep going to are they're drinking from saltwater pools trying to find refreshment and can't understand why they simply feel worse and worse. And if you don't believe me, go into any bookstore while they still exist. Walk back to a section and you will find that there's the largest section in just about any bookstore, unfortunately even including Christian bookstores, is entitled Self-Help. How to Fix Yourself. And what amazes me, and what should be the biggest attention grabber when we go into that, we see the self-help book, is we should see that there's thousands of them. And they keep writing them. And it should be just be this, a little alarm should go off in our head and they go, if they keep writing all these books, and that means they haven't found one that works yet. So self-help doesn't really work, which means we have to go above ourselves to find meaning for our life. And Jesus says, here I am, I'm the way. A constant in this world, that in the only constant you'll ever find. And he follows that up by saying, and I'm the truth. Which means that there is a universal truth in this world, and it can be found in Christ. And that's one of those things that we have been arguing about since mankind took its first breath. It means that there is a right and a wrong, and it's not determined by us. And we like hearing that, and we don't like hearing that, and we've been arguing about it forever. I've been reading a book by, and see, now this is one of those times where I reach out and the name just goes, who wrote The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe? Somebody knows this. C.S. Lewis. I've been reading Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis. And the awesome thing is he'll say, we will all agree that there's a right and wrong thing. Now, it might change by the situation. And he'll say, it was a perfectly good and honorable thing for you to share your candy bar with me. But when you asked for me to share my candy bar with you, that right and wrong changes very quickly. So we can't determine where right and wrong begins. And we can see that as we look throughout human history, as people say things like, I'm right, you're wrong. No, I'm right, you're wrong. And we have all these wonderful things from everything from arguments over where we're going to eat all the way up to wars over who is right. Lest you forget, there was literally a war fought in England at one point in time on who had the best hunting dog. It's a real thing. Look it up. We will fight about right and wrong forever. Because if we look for truth outside of Christ, we will only ever lead to division. And you can see that blatantly clear in the world today. Right and wrong are only found in Christ. And he says, it's because of who I am. Because when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I am in the Father, and the Father is in me. You've seen us. The author of creation is standing before them, and once again, they don't get it. I love Philip. He looks at him and goes, "You know what, Lord? I believe you. All you have to do is just show me the Father." We talked about this yesterday. Any person who encountered God to their face, the response wasn't, "Wow, it was, I'm doomed." We saw Isaiah when he hit the ground and says, "Well, I'm an unclean person. I'm not going to survive this." When God came and rested on the mountain and the flames and the smoke and the lightning crashed about, the people of God didn't go, "Yay, God's with us." They went, "Oh, we're not going to survive this. Moses, you go talk to him and leave us alone." And yet here's Philip. "Just show me the Father, Lord, and it'll be enough." Good grief, man. You don't know what you're asking for. And yet Jesus looks at him and goes, "Don't you know me?" It's one of those things that I looked at him and I was like, "Jesus, I really wish you just would have said, 'I am. Here I am. Don't you know me? We've walked together all these times, Phillips. Who else have you walked with where as we go, the blind receive their sight, the deaf speak, the lame leap for joy, and the dead get up and tell you how good God is? Don't you see me, Philip?" It was revealed in prophecies, fulfilled in so much more as we just witnessed his life and how he loved people. Holy God, Almighty God, revealed in Christ. And it's the holiness that we see in Christ that just, to me, is just the foundation of the proof of who he is. I love all the different prophecies. Yeah, all 324 of them. 324 of them were fulfilled. That's awesome. That's cool. Don't get me wrong. That's amazing. But when I see the interactions with Christ with others, that's the proof for me of who he is. One of the biggest ones that counts for me comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 8. This is Matthew 8, verses 1 through 4. It says, "When he came down from the mountain, great crowds followed him, and behold, a leper came to him and knelt before him, saying, 'Lord, if you will, you can make me clean.' And Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, 'I will, be clean.' And immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, 'See that you say nothing to anyone, but go show yourself to the priest and offer the gift that Moses commanded for proof to them.'" A leper. That we think of leprosy, we think of disease, and we go, they were all terrified by getting disease. Oh yeah, that was there. But you have to understand, there were purity laws surrounding this gentleman as well. He had a law, if anybody got within 12 feet of him, he had to ring a bell and scream out, "Unclean," lest somebody get too close. And it wasn't just so they wouldn't get sick, it was so that they literally would not become unclean. Because the people of Israel were very focused on being ceremonially clean. There were all these different Levitical laws and all these different ways you had to wash your hands and all these different ways you had to eat your food and all these different ways and different ways and different ways. And they loved arguing about them. See, that's you know, the real truth thing we just talked about. And here comes this man. And he sees something in Jesus that even the disciples haven't seen yet. And he's been alone. Because if anybody gets near him, they're ostracized from the community until they go through all the different rituals, pay all the different tributes, sacrifice the right things to become clean again. So we don't know how long this man has been in solitude. And he comes up and he comes close to Jesus and he just hits his knees. And I imagine he's sobbing. But look what he asks for. He doesn't say, "Lord, can you heal me?" He says, "If you will, you can make me what? Clean. Make me clean, Lord. I can deal with the pain. I can deal with the sickness. Just make me clean so I can have family again." And I love this because you see, Jesus doesn't just care about what's going on with the individual. He cares about the individual, because the man who has not felt the touch of another human forever is embraced by Emmanuel. And he says, "I will be clean." Jesus, don't you know what you're doing? Don't you understand what you've done? You have touched tainted flesh. You're going to make yourself unclean by your actions, but this is holy God wrapped in flesh. And when sin and uncleanliness encounter the holy in this instance, because of who it is, it doesn't become unclean. It becomes purified. And to the amazement of the disciples, they bear witness to the sickness purged before their very eyes. Because one who was unclean, one who was in sin, has been touched by Almighty Holy God, and their life is transformed by it. But he doesn't just restore his illness. He doesn't just make him clean right there. He goes as far as to say, now go to the priests, show yourself clean so that you can be fully restored. I have given you everything you need. Now go show them. The first thing out of those priests' mouths should have been, how is this possible? We don't get that part of the story. This is one of those things that one of these days when I get to heaven, I'm going to chase down this guy and go, what happened when you got to the temple? Because if I was the one in the temple, and I imagine this guy would have been somewhat known. He would at least have the clothing on at this point in time that was recognizable as a leper. Because believe me, they had all these things they had to do. And suddenly he comes in there and he's perfectly fine. I would have went, what did you do? How did this happen? Tell me everything. Make me clean. Lord, make me clean. I can't stand it another day. We don't use that language anymore, but it's still a reality. The brokenness that sin brings about, that's what they're talking about. They're trying to give tangible substance to sin at this moment. There's a pastor, he's an elder in the church by the name of Oslin Bachrat. I love the guy. He's like 4'10" of pure dynamite. When I was in WVU, he was the senior pastor at Suncrest United Methodist Church, and Steve Meadows was the associate pastor, and we, being in the college group, lovingly called them Ozzy and Steve-O. And you would see these guys in full, the robes, the stoles, the crosses, and everything, and they would walk into the room, and you would kind of have this reverence, and from the back of the college group, you would get, Ozzy! And the whole church would start laughing. But he had this story because he was a first-generation immigrant from the Middle East. He was a Christian in the midst of Islamic Middle East community. This was the life that he grew up with. And he used to talk about he would tell this story to try and help us to understand what he meant by ceremonially unclean, because they played a game when they were teenagers. And he would say, I'm not saying that I was always a good kid, but nobody is. So going into a mosque, there's always a little bridge. It's one of these symbols of being separate from the world. And he and his buddies would hide underneath the bridge. And when they would, the Islamic people would come in, they had all these ceremonial rituals they went through to be clean. And they had this nice little white outfit that they wore as they went into the mosque. And they would wait till somebody would start walking across that. And we go, ha ha, gotcha. And they would go, ah! And they'd have to go back home and wash all over again and get all new clothes and do all that kind of stuff. And they would come back and they would start looking on the bridge, and they would go to the other side of the bridge and go, ha ha, gotcha. And that's all it took. But yet we see Jesus literally touch a leper. He doesn't become unclean. The leper becomes clean. It's amazing, because when sin and brokenness encounter holy God, everything changes, because we're looking at 100% God and 100% human. He's not contaminated. Rather, the contamination is cleansed. This is what it means when we say Emmanuel is here with us. This is why Paul says it's worth everything to have him. Philippians chapter 3. I love his language here. I got to get to the right thing here. This is Philippians 3, verses 1 through 14. It says, finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you is no trouble to me, and it is safe for you. Look out for those dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh, for we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish in order that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I might attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I've already obtained this, or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Jesus Christ. I love this. He starts it off with, it's not about your pedigree. And he goes, and if you want to make it an issue of pedigree, mine's better than yours. He goes, I'm the best. I'm the Hebrew of Hebrews. I was a Pharisee. I was so righteous, I persecuted the church with such zeal that they feared my very name. And can I tell you that it was worth setting all that aside and losing everything that I thought was worth it just to gain Christ. I love that testimony, all this. Because what he says, what he's saying is, it doesn't matter what you have. He's saying, are you his? That's what matters. And that's the one thing that I see folks battle with the most when they talk about coming to church or getting to know Jesus. I always hear about what they'll have to give up. I have to give up something, and that something is different. But what I always tell them is, give them a year and I'll tell you what you'll lose. That's something that was so important, you'll look back and go, I can't believe why I treasured that, because look at what I've gained. Because he'll take your pain and instead he'll give you love. He'll take your addiction and instead give you security. He'll take anything that we might hold on to and call good and reveal us what has been harming us the entire time and instead give us a family, a love, and a righteousness that comes from him and not us. And we will look back and go, I can't believe how hard I fought to stay away when I realize how good it is to be here with you. He says, everything I had before, I consider it worthless when I compare to having Christ. And be understanding that when Paul is writing these things, he's not sitting in a five-star hotel on a nice writing tablet. He's in prison. He's talking about how good God is. And, and get the mental image of a modern-day prison out of your head. This is a hole that he apparently has at least enough light that people can give him some writing materials that he can see. This is not comfortable. This is miserable. And he's telling you, it's so much worth it. Because I couldn't get it in the law. I tried. See, now we as Gentiles, we have a different meaning for the law. The law for us is perfect at revealing our sin, which is why we don't like it so much. Which is why when we get to that big book, we go, let's get to the next one and keep going. Because I don't want to read everything that I've done wrong. And by the way, we've all done wrong, just in case you didn't know. But I could just look around and tell you, most of you, just based off of what you ate for dinner and how your hair is styled, according to the law, you messed up somewhere. And if you didn't need that, I always tell people, if you could just go through all those commandments and say, no, I'm keeping every single one of them. I've not done anything wrong. I'm just fine and perfect and dandy. I'll tell you, there's one called pride. Look it up. It's perfect at revealing our sin. And it's perfect at doing that so that we might realize that we can't do it on our own. And repent. And I mean repent, because there's a false narrative going around in the church right now that faith begins in belief. It does not begin in belief. It begins in repentance. Amen. I just don't understand how there's all these preachers going out there saying, if you will just believe in Jesus, that's enough, when Jesus himself says, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. Because you can't have belief until you acknowledge, I can't do it on my own. And repentance is acknowledging that, Lord, the direction I'm heading in is just going to lead to my destruction. And I need you so that I can turn my life around. And I can only do that if you come into it. I need you, Lord. That's what repentance is simply acknowledging I can't do it myself. You want proof you can't do it yourself? Buy a boxed meal and try making it. And look at the directions once. You don't know what I'm talking about. How many times have you ever made macaroni and cheese? You pick up the box, you read the direction, you throw it in the trash, you walk over to the pot, you go, then you walk back over to the trash and you pick it back up and you look, you know, you can't do it yourself. You can't. If you could do it yourself, then we would not have needed Jesus. And Jesus himself prayed, Lord, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. But regardless, your will be done. If it was not necessary for Jesus to go to the cross, then he would not have. It was a necessity. I'll get it out. And I love it. He goes even as far as to remind us. He says, now, you know, don't get haughty because I've not even gained it all yet. But I'm striving for it. I press on to make it my own. And I love that because what he's saying is lean so far into Christ that he's all that holds you up. When you can do that, then you really understand what faith is. Because you see, we're going through this race of life together, but it's not a race as we traditionally understand it. It's not looking for a winner. It's gathering other racers. Because there's this old... I'm not old enough to have this many blanks in a sermon.
Yes, you are.
Gosh, Rosemary, I know who that was. I know the word. The word's right here. Sojourners. We are sojourners. A sojourner is somebody who is on a foreign land heading home. The difference is they take people with them. And that's who we are. There's an old saying that Reverend Arthur said to me once, and it has stuck with me some 15 plus years now. He said, you know what is better than going to hell, better than going to heaven, and worse than going to hell? Taking someone with you. We are called to gather those around us, to join into the journey as we sojourn together home. Do you believe that's possible? Because if you go back to the conversation that he had with Nathaniel and Philip, he ends it in an interesting way. And it's one of those scriptures that we tend to skip over because we either don't understand it or we fear it. Because he says, you will go and do greater things than even I have. And the Christian people look at that and go, nah. And go on. If we believe his promise that we can be forgiven, why don't we hold on to that one? You will do great things in my name. All you have to do is ask. Lord, I pray for my brother who doesn't know you. Lord, I pray for my family that they might come to you. And we think that's not enough. We think somehow that's pathetic when we realize that we're talking to the one sitting on the throne who loves his children dearly. You will do things greater than I. Do you believe it? Because you are empowered to do that. If we will only listen to the Spirit. The Spirit is necessary in our walk. Christians fear the Spirit. It's true. It's because we can't control it. We don't like things we can't control. It's the truth. But Jesus himself said, it's a good thing that I go to heaven so that the Helper can come here. Think about that when you think about the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, it is better for me to not be here so that the Spirit can come. And we think the opposite of that sometimes. If somebody, Jesus, if you were just standing here and could tell me what to do, that's all I need. And he says, no, it's better that I'm up there talking to the Father for you. I sent the Spirit to help you. Are you listening? Will you respond? As we come to our closing hymn, which is I'd Rather Have Jesus. It's in the Favorite Hymns of Praise book. So I think they're green and blue. page 106. I invite you, come and listen. 106. Come and spend some time with God. And I tell this to my congregation, every church I've ever been in. If your fear is that if I go up there, somebody will think what's wrong with me, they need to come right up with you if that's the first thing that crossed their head anyways. If you'd like to spend some time with Jesus, hey, if your life's going perfect, I guarantee you, you know somebody who's struggling. Won't you come? I'd rather have Jesus.
Thank you. into just to the brim, but into an overflow. And that overflow has a purpose. It's so that as we go from here, because this isn't church ending, this is the church going out into God's world. It's so that in that overflow, you can splash His goodness on anybody that gets here. So as you go from here, do that. Be that weirdo that just splashes the love of God on everybody, because this world needs it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we go from here, we just pray that anything that has been done and said that glorifies you, you would write it upon our hearts. That as we go from here, we might have it, Lord, for when we need it or for when we need to share it. Send us out, Lord, in that overflow that the world might be changed in your name for your glory as we go from here. And take us back to our homes in safety. In Jesus' name, all the saints of God.